Good evening and welcome to MTV News Update for today, Tuesday, March 20, 2018. In the news tonight, Robbie's River Bridge may collapse due to low maintenance, says specialist engineer. Social workers urge to demonstrate professionalism as the world celebrates World Social Work Day. Public Health Ministry seeking regulations to protect citizens from the abuse and misuse of medications. And in court, statements serve to have Anthony Thomas extradited to face a murder charge in the U.S. With the details of these and other stories, I'm Sandy Ramutar, thanking you for joining us. Now for the news and details. The life of the Burbies River Bridge may soon come to an end. Experts have calculated that poor management and maintenance may be the cause. Nick Adondo opens tonight's newscast.
Specialist engineer Bert Carter says a team of engineers have presented a detailed plan to the Burbies River Bridge Company to have a proper maintenance program for the bridge. Carter posited that the Burbies River Bridge Company may be holding back because of the high cost to maintain each pontoon. He also noted that in order for maintenance to take place, each of the 39 pontoons will have to float all the way to the Demerara River dry docks to be examined. Carter said for the cost of that exercise, over $2 million is needed for each pontoon to travel to the dry docks and return. The engineer was making a presentation at Murray House, located at Camp and Kwamina Streets, Georgetown.
Bring everyone back to Georgetown with $1 million each, or you create your own dry dock? No?
It might be good in this case, so you have to see at least $1 million back to Georgetown. I guess it will cost a lot more to build a dry dock in Amsterdam there. So right now, maybe invest I agree
with you. The cheap cost, to see what kind of funeral you can get.
The specialist engineer went further to state that the Burbies River Bridge Company's maintenance crew is only focused on the structures above the waterline. He noted that below the waterline, there is no maintenance being carried out. That, he noted, is a worrying trend for the life of the bridge, given that since it was commissioned, there has been no maintenance.
In 2015, when we dredged the vicinity pontoon number 3, the idea was to be able to remove it and put it in the reserve pontoon. But then that happened, so the still just built up again. The truth of the matter is, exactly what Mr. Valmiki said is where we had planned. Take out one pontoon, look at the situation, determine the rate of change, because if it was in good health, you might do one every other month, as money came along. If it was in a bad way, you might have to do one every week, so to speak. The 39 pontoons can't be done in 39 days, you know, because it takes about 2 weeks to get a pontoon in and out. And then the tide is down your face, you can't really walk in the night. It's quite a nightmare when you think about it, but, you know, you're not speaking to anybody who's really to listen.
President of the Burbies Chamber of Commerce and Development Association, Ryan Alexander, also expressed grave disappointment with the bridge company. He noted that the management of the bridge has held several meetings with the officials in the region. However, this matter was not on their agenda.
I seldomly see them at meetings. They have not raised this concern with this, with the Burbies Chamber of Commerce and Development Association. I am also a part of the Private Sector Commission, of which they are a part of also. And I have not heard anything at the Private Sector Commission to this nature of the seriousness as it pertains to the maintenance of the Burbies River Bridge and the type of problems that it will pose if that bridge go down.
The bridge was officially opened on December 23, 2008 by former President Bar Jagdeo. The structure links regions 5 and 6, giving residents of the two regions easy access to cross the river. Before the bridge was constructed, everyone had to use the ferry service between Rosignol and New Amsterdam. Nikhil John, the reporting for MTV News Update.
As the Public Health Ministry intends to protect citizens from the abuse and misuse of the medications, regulation will be upgraded for the pharmaceutical industry. So says Chief Medical Officer Dr. Shamdeep Prasad. Let's hear more. through the Ministry of Public Health, laws, acts, regulation and policies are expected to be upgraded to guide the pharmaceutical industry. This follows the wide use of antibiotic, the existence of illegal pharmacies and other irregularities listed by patients. Chief Medical Officer Dr. Shamdeep Prasad says there has over time been a challenge in monitoring the industry. As such, measures will be put in place to ensure the population is protected from the abuse and misuse of medications.
The global challenge includes the wide range of production sites that are there in various settings, the range of products that are produced, which varies from simple cosmetic type interventions, but can be deemed as treatment or can have detrimental effect if they are not used correctly. And the whole issue of the movement of pharmaceutical, including the illicit movements across borders.
Another worrying issue is the movement of medication, which will be stringently pursued, especially at the borders. He also believes non-traditional medicines should be addressed to ensure quality assurance. According to him, the ministry has engaged the Karikam Commission on Marijuana to peruse the medical benefits of the substance.
This aspect of drug control has actually taken a turn for maybe not such a good reason, but in many other developed countries, there are provisions now for recreational use of some of these substances. We're not sure if we're ready for that. We're not sure if and we still, the verdict is still out and discussion is still going on.
The pharmaceutical and medicine policy is expected to be reviewed by a team spearheaded by the World Health Organization and the Public Health Ministry. As social workers continue to fight for human rights and social justice to strengthen communities, they were charged to demonstrate professionalism. This message was given to them on March 20, celebrating World Social Work Day. Find out more in this report. March 20th every year is celebrated as World Social Work Day. The day brings together social workers from across the globe to celebrate the numerous achievements in their profession. Permanent Secretary of the Ministry of Social Protection, Lorraine Baird, charged the social workers to undertake their profession with dedication. She urged that they be resilient to ensure vulnerable persons in society are counseled.
I would like to encourage social workers to be resilient and to continue to strive for the change you want to see as you endeavor to improve the well-being of our society and the country as a whole. I encourage you to be proud of your profession and to continue to undertake your commitments with passion and dedication.
President of the Ghana Association of Professional Social Workers, Arnold Mickle, is peeved as he claimed social workers do not see themselves as professionals.
So those who have gone before, those who have graced the association with their presence and have contributed, the doors are still open. You have not outgrown the profession. You need to come back that we can have an association that is highly professional with all the highly skilled professional persons we have in our society. So my appeal is to have all of you to come back home.
With about 1 million graduates from the University of Guyana, just about 20 is said to be actively involved in the association. The Social Protection Ministry, in appreciation of their work, presented awards to long-standing social workers. More news still ahead. Do stay tuned.
BB, is we're going with so much Windex for clean windows. All them fancy curtains, it's not even Christmas.
Hi girl, mind your own business. I got big plans.
But BB, your house don't even have windows.
Girl, you ain't think I know it ain't got window? Yes, I know it ain't got window. But look, Mokesh promised me that he carrying me down by the window factory when he come home. Eccles. It named Beeson. Like you know nothing, girl. Right now, everybody talking about how Beeson got the strongest windows. Plus, they got a deal right now. If you buy 10 windows, you get a free bathroom window. So I could mind your business instead of you minding me own.
Beeson Windows and Doors, serving Guyana with the highest quality standard windows for your home, office, or commercial building.
What good is history if you never change? And what good is change if it doesn't make you better? At Valvoline, for the last 150 years, we've been doing just that. Relentlessly pursuing innovation for your engine. Backed up not just by science, but by the hands-on expertise that drives everything we do. Valvoline, 150 years under the hood.
Hey, you have a growing flesh there, and there too, and there is another one. Those ugly and annoying growing flesh, like a plague. Ignoring them, and before you know, you have them everywhere. SlimJet, presenting Coleomac, the most effective growing flesh and wart remover. Painlessly remove ugly growing flesh. It's the quick and effective way. Get soft, smooth, growing flesh-free skin, guarantee. Just apply Coleomac twice a day and the growing flesh just dry up and fall off. Easy, quick, and painless. Stop suffering and feeling embarrassed. Remove those ugly growing flesh with Coleomac. Only at SlimJet, City Mall, second floor.
Anticipated comedy to hit the National Cultural Center. You are for it and now.
Tell me what?
You know what she's talking about.
It's Diane McCalmont's Woman in Law, Part 2. On Friday, March 23, Saturday, March 24, Sunday, March 25. Tickets $2,000, $1,500, and $1,000.
Come on. When I tell you what happened, this woman is coming back in my house.
Yes. Hey, Frankie, it's about time you include me then. Out your mouth.
Wait, man. When it's up, break free. Just tell that my house, eh? Wait, you hold on, right? You is blasphemy.
Hey, my sister, you think it is a time. It's 7 days a week, it's got, and I got seven more men, and he will keep me company. And Lord, I got three women to go and come as I please.
Yeah, you want
to
come on, please.
It's blasphemy. Hey, now, eat today.
No, don't come back in this house, you're telling you? Eh? You're like a satanic butterfly!
Tickets available at the National Cultural Center, Giftland Mall, Gizmos and Gadgets, Nigel Supermarket, Andrew Supermarket, and Sir Mars. Showtime, 20 hours. Supported by the Giftland Mall. This is exclusive comedy you don't want to miss.
You're still with News Update. Welcome back. The Strategic Management Unit of the Guyana Police Force has benefited from a contribution from the United States Embassy. $20,000 in equipment was handed over, used to boost the force's capacity to address the modern crimes. Here's more from Nikhil Jondu.
The Guyana Police Force has been able to acquire additional equipment from the United States Embassy for the force's Strategic Planning Unit. The equipment will be used to enhance the force's capacity to address modern crimes. U.S. Ambassador to Guyana Perry Holloway says the equipment is worth approximately $20,000. He noted that the equipment is being allocated through the Caribbean Basin Security Initiative, CBSI. Holloway said since the establishment of the CBSI in 2010, the U.S. has been heavily supporting efforts to combat the illegal drug trade and other transnational crimes.
Through donations like this and others in the future, the U.S. Embassy commits itself to assisting the government of Guyana, law enforcement institutions to promote the development of accountable and professional criminal justice system. We hold citizen security as paramount and applaud the government and the Strategic Planning Union's efforts to reform Guyana's security sector, as well as our UK friends who are helping out and providing some technical assistance so then the police can move forward.
Acting Commissioner of Police David Ramnarine thanked the U.S. Ambassador for the timely donation. Ramnarine said the government is on the move to have security reform at a time when the country's law enforcement agencies are undergoing specialized training.
We had quite an important piece of training done for the members of the strategic planning unit of the Guyana Police Force. That unit would be charged. They have already begun to do some work, but largely upcoming work, which will lead to the much needed reforms in the Guyana Police Force. And so we've had that training, and also two members of the Surinamese Police Force benefited.
Nikhil John, the reporting for MTV News Update.
The Ministry of Public Telecommunications has initiated a pilot program to target girls within the information and communications technology sector. Outreach coordinator Donella Collison believes with the 12-week training program, females will flock the sector. Find out more from Yanis Abrams.
Outreach coordinator for the Ministry of Public Telecommunications, Donella Collison, is calling for girls to be a part of a program called Guyanese Girls Code. The 12-week pilot program will cater for girls from Forms 1 to 3. Collison mentioned that the program is to deal with the disparity of gender in the information and communications technology sector. Further, the program was initiated after it was noticed that there is only one woman in every five individuals in a computer science classroom.
Well, this project, the aim of this project is to deal with the disparity of women in Guyana's ICT field, in Guyana's computer sector. We have a very new, burgeoning ICT computer technology sector going on here in Guyana, where there are a number of companies started by young individuals, but what we've noticed is a disparity of women who are in that field. Currently at UG, about one in five students in the computer science department is a woman, and the graduation statistics are even less. There have been entire classes where there's one or two women graduating in the computer science field.
The outreach coordinator mentioned the ministry's mission is to collaborate with other ministries, non-governmental organizations, and the private sector to extend the opportunity to other girls in Guyana. The training program is expected to be held at the National Center for Education Resource Development in Kingston, Georgetown.
This initiative is for girls who are in first, third form. So, and we decided to attack that age because that's during the period where a lot of our schools don't really do computer technology. They usually start doing the computer technology classes in fourth form in preparation for CXC, which by that time it just might be a little bit too late for some persons to develop that interest to be able to, you know, write the exams right off the bat. So there are a number of issues that we're hoping to tackle with this pilot initiative. We're just really hoping that it catches on. It becomes, you know, a thing in Guyana where we start to think of, whenever we think about technology, we have young girls and women doing, you know, from whatever it is that women care about, whether it's addressing women healthcare needs, whether it's fashion, whether it's anything in the wide scope of interests that are particularly for women.
Reporting for MTV's News Update, I am Yanis Abrams.
The fire which endangered the main pipelines of the Guyana Power & Light leading to the fuel tank is still on investigation by the Guyana Fire Service. The investigators are still to ascertain the cause of the blaze. Here are the details from Nikhil Jondu.
The Guyana Fire Service is still investigating the circumstances that led to the fire at the Guyana Power & Light Company. Fire investigators were back at the scene this morning as they continue to search for the cause of the fire. It is still unclear what may have led to the truck exploding close to the fuel pipes. The fire engulfed a section of the power company fuel pipes just behind the building that once housed the generation sets. Fire Chief Marlon Gentle told media operatives that the fire started following the explosion of a truck. He noted that the vehicle was parked next to the pipes leading to the main fuel tank and burst into flames. The fire chief also noted that the fire engines were summoned quickly to the location, averting a major disaster.
We have been doing a lot of in-house
exercises with the GPL and Demerara Power Company over the last 2 or 3 years, and definitely this was not a rehearsal, but we were able to do a proper response and a timely response to this facility.
Firefighters sprung into action to quickly contain the blaze with water and foam. Nikhil Jondu reporting for MTV News Update.
When we return, Sherrod Duncan upset with the electoral process at City Hall, which denied him the opportunity to make a nomination.
In today's fast-paced world of modern finance, with its many options and opportunities, you will need good advice and help getting value for your money. Hand-in-Hand Trust is the way to go, from owning your own home or business. With our residential and commercial mortgages, we'll help you realize your dreams. You can also access investment deposit accounts, share brokerage services, personal trust, thrift and pension plan trusteeship, property management, investment portfolio management, safe deposit boxes, the convenience of our Cambio, Western Union, and Bill Express services. Hand in Hand Trust for financial services and more. Helping you get the most out of your financial resources and your life.
Everything is connected. Our planet, our water sources, including the water we drink. Sometimes harmful bacteria end up in our streams and canals. Although treated, the risks are high. You can prevent this pollution and contamination by maintaining your septic tank and grease traps. Call the experts at Pooran Brothers Disposal Incorporated on 264-1239 or 603-5050. Keeping it clean is what we do best.
Modern Optical Service has made it even better by introducing its budgeted spectacle line, starting as low as $10,000 for a single vision lens and $12,000 for bifocal lens, available in tinted or clear, complete spectacles at affordable prices. So hurry down to our main office at 316 Middle Street or Lot 14 Diamond Public Road opposite Demerara Bank. Enjoy over 60 years of eye care experience at affordable prices. Modern Optical Service, your eye care professionals.
Introducing the new Softex toilet tissue, now available across Guyana. Softex is silky smooth because it's made from virgin pulp. Softex is soft and gentle to every touch. Even babies can use it. Manufactured and distributed by BPATS Paper Manufacturing, Eccles Industrial Site. The choice is clear. Choose Softex toilet tissue, super soft and super durable, guaranteed.
If you love anime or your favorite video characters, then this one is for you. Introducing the Cosplay Show at the Innovate Expo, presented by GTT on March 24 and 25 at the Marriott Hotel. Come see your favorite characters. Come dressed as your favorite characters. Enter our fashion show and you could win up to $200,000 of prizes to be won. See robots. All up close, live, and personal. Enjoy the cosplay at the Innovate Expo, only from GTT, Guyana's number one network.
This is MTV News Update. Thank you for staying tuned. Following the mayoral and deputy mayoral election at City Hall on March 15, Councillor Sherrod Duncan has come out and is claiming that the mayor is biased. He is also urging the deputy mayor-elect, Akeem Peter, to be a strong and forceful deputy mayor. Yanis Abrams with the details.
On March 15, the City Council held its annual mayoral and deputy mayoral elections, where Patricia Chase Green retained her position and Akeem Peter secured the position of deputy mayor. During the nomination process of deputy mayor, Councillor Sherrod Duncan, along with Tricia Richards, stood at the same time. However, Chase Green acknowledged Richards, who closed nomination. It is against this backdrop that Duncan stated he does not understand why the mayor did not allow him to make his nomination. Duncan believes last week's electoral process was one that was biased.
I find it very surprising that with just one nomination that the mayor would have accepted the motion to close nominations. I don't see any reason why she would not have allowed another nomination. The mayor knows that the numbers are on their side. I mean, even if it's for the pretense of a democratic process, there was no need for her not to accept the additional nomination. We weren't running late. We were about 20-25 minutes into the into the meeting, and so I don't know on what basis, either than on just pure bias, the mayor would have disallowed me from making the nomination of my colleague Lionel Jaikaran.
During an exclusive interview with the councillor, Duncan mentioned that he would like to see the deputy mayor-elect to continue the tradition of being a strong and forceful deputy mayor.
Akeem has his role cut out for him, definitely so. And Akeem is, I call him a colleague, but we will not give an inch to issues that we are strong on, that the wrongs that we are seeing at City Hall. And if Akeem is seen in any way to condone those wrongs, we will come as hard against Akeem as we have done the town clerk and the mayor. Because at the end of the day, this is not about friends, it's not about colleagues, it's about the interests of the people of Georgetown we are representing. We call him a colleague, and we do hope that he continues in the path that we have set in being very strong against the many issues at City Hall that he has himself in the past been strongly against.
Akeem Peter will officially become the deputy mayor from April 1, 2018. Reporting for MTV's News Update, I am Yanis Abrams.
The minimum standards for elderly resident homes across the country is an issue actively being monitored by the Ministry of Social Protection, says Director of Social Services, Wentworth Tanner. Find out more from Lashana Gomes, Cornelius.
The minimum standards for all senior citizen homes fall within a complete range of achievable outcomes for in-care residents, the impact on the residents of the facilities and the services offered at those homes. In Guyana, the elderly population requires systems pertinent to their needs and care. According to the Director of Social Services, Wentworth Tanner, the Ministry of Social Protection, in working to enhance all elderly facilities nationwide, is currently placing much focus in those facilities as each work to adapt and maintain minimum standards.
There is a minimum standards for elderly residential facilities. There is a visiting committee has been set up to visit those elderly residential facilities, those registered elderly residential facilities, because as you know, we have some very informal arrangements. But once those come to our attention, of course, we also work again with our partners at Ministry of Health and the other sister agencies to ensure that we try to bring them in line with the minimum standard.
While noting that there are many elderly facilities that lack majorly on the requirements of the minimum standards, Tanner acknowledged that both the Ministry of Social Protection and the Ministry of Public Health are actively engaging those facilities to step up their game in putting systems and actions in place to ensure all senior residents be afforded proper care.
The minimum standards really and truly, we are working towards building the capacity in many of these homes, because many of them, they really fall very short of these minimum standards. But it is not to be punitive, at least not in the embryonic stages. It is for us to work with these homes to build their capacity that they can reach the minimum standards. Our intention in the short term is not to shut down these homes or to penalize them, but to work with them so that they can provide the best possible service.
Reporting for MTV News Update, Lashana Gomes, Cornelius.
In an effort to heighten security against floods in parts of Guyana's coast, the Ministry of Agriculture, with efforts through the National Drainage and Irrigation Authority, have already started to consult and install several drainage and irrigation structures as the May-June rainy season approaches. Here's more from the Shauna Gomes, Cornelius.
Unlike other well-known zones prone to flooding, the chosen locations of Lusignan, Friendship, Vigilance, Buxton and Enmore for new pump stations have over the years been repeatedly neglected. Those constructions are said to cost government over $581 million. In addition, the community of Triumph, also located on the east coast of Demerara, has been identified as the location for the construction of another pump station. During a post-cabinet press briefing held on Friday, March 9, Minister of State Joseph Harmon had announced that cabinet had approved several contracts for the construction and rehabilitation of several sea defense locations on parts of the Essequibo coast, as had been previously agreed to. Minister Harmon had stressed, while the administration remains committed to ensuring citizens are protected from the effects of floods and other forms of natural disasters, citizens should also strive to live by best practices important in preventing such devastating consequences. With the stark reality that climate change is unsympathetic to persons and the environment, best practices on the part of each individual will in a major way help to minimize the effects of climate change to some level, the minister had noted. Reporting for MTV News Update, Lashona Gomes, Cornelius.
Still ahead, Region 2 RDC continues to complain against the alleged arbitrary actions of the REO. Stay tuned.
I want a secret, so I can't tell you. A secret of a secret. Me go, palam. And hear me catch you.
The secret is out. Tyos Future Shop is the absolute best place to shop if you're looking for quality products at the lowest prices in the widest possible variety. Choose from a vast array of custom-made quality wooden furniture in endless designs, electrical and household appliances, clothing, cell phones and accessories, and much, much more.
Oh my God, so much thing this store got! Me confused! And a price low too!
Tayo's Future Shop and Household Appliances, located at Anna Katerina, West Coast, Demerara. Free delivery available.
Credit, now me know the secret.
I like all you know the secret. Everybody know the secret.
You can be a millionaire by only spending $100 on a Daily Million ticket. Simply pick any five numbers from 1 to 26, or you can buy a quick pick for your chance to win the Daily Millions. Purchase your tickets daily, Monday through Saturday, to get a chance to win $1 million every day. So, feeling lucky? Then buy a Daily Millions ticket today. Remember, a ticket today could make you rich today.
Mark?
I'm in the kitchen.
This is amazing! I love your tiles.
Make an impression with the finest tiles imported by Lens. Lens has a huge selection of various tiles for your wall, floor, and pool needs. All of our tiles are of grade A quality, which are the highest quality tile rated. That means they last longer and are less likely to damage or crack. We're the sole distributor for many reputable companies around the world. At Lens, we have special deals for contractors and bulk shoppers. Shop at any of our three locations to get the best in tiles. Lens, our product, your creation.
If you love anime or your favorite video characters, then this one is for you. Introducing the Cosplay Show at the Innovate Expo, presented by GTT on March 24 and 25 at the Marriott Hotel. Come see your favorite characters. Come dressed as your favorite characters. Enter our fashion show and you could win up to $200,000 of prizes to be won. See robots, all up close, live, and personal. Enjoy the cosplay at the Innovate Expo, only from GTT, Guyana's number one network.
You're tuned to News Update. Welcome back. The Region 2 Regional Democratic Council has expressed dissatisfaction with the commencement of projects implemented for 2018. The region's chairman says all the blame points to the regional executive officer. Here's more. Despite repeated calls by the Regional Democratic Council of Region 2 for enhanced transparency and accountability, projects of poor quality continue to be executed in the region. So says Chairman of the Region, Devanand Ramdat. Recommendations were over time made to the Regional Executive Officer, Rupert Hopkinson, to ensure a number of projects commenced, but to no avail.
The other thing is there is need for a number of community roads and schools and health centers and health posts to be for repairs and maintenance to be done. Access dam rice cultivation is being done presently. And unfortunately, the REO has not been given much attention to those areas.
One such concern is the construction of a road in Lima Sands. The project is somewhat controversial as there were no consultations. The Lima Sands leads into the backlands of the Essequibo coast, where farming and forestry are done. As such, tractors and trucks frequent these roads. Ramdat claimed the road under construction has a narrow stretch coupled with weak shoulders, resulting from a poor quality design.
Well, the Lima Sands Road, the vice chair, who is chairs the works committee along with another member of the RDC. From the government side, they visited, along with the prime minister representative, and they submitted a report raising concerns as to the quality of work, and of course we're calling for a review of that particular project.
As such, the chairman has ordered the works committee to inspect the project and provide a report. This follows the REO failure to intervene despite being written to about on the matter. The Gyanu Water Incorporated has dismantled a fence illegally built near the Lamaha Canal. Managing Director of GWI, Dr. Richard Van Westchals, stated that the company cannot allow such lawlessness to continue. Yanis Abrams with the details.
The Gyanu Water Incorporated, in its effort to provide better quality water to consumers, dismantled a fence which was illegally built near the Lamaha Canal. In a press statement, Managing Director of GWI, Dr. Richard Van Westchals, who was on site as workers dismantled the fence, said the company cannot encourage such a level of encroachment, which he described as lawless. Further, action will be taken towards the persons along the canal who were seen encroaching on 66 feet of GWI territory. In 2015, a fence was erected which the company claims is owned by Peter Ramsrup, and as of recently, it was noticed that the fence behind the last house had moved to take in more land. The Lamaha Canal is utilized by GWI's Shelter Belt Water Treatment Plant. Reporting for MTV's News Update, I am Yanis Abrams.
With Karakara already identified to be the location for the construction of Region 10's sanitary landfill site, Linden's Mayor Karen Holland revealed that the council is still awaiting the report on the survey carried out early last year on the town's sanitation rules. Here's more from the Shana Gomes, Cornelius.
Holland noted while the final report on the design has not yet been released to the public, it is his understanding that the facility is eagerly anticipated by all.
I know that, you know, the research with the study which the government had done, their initial investigation on the location, that I understand was completed, and but we didn't receive the report as yet. We're still awaiting the report, but we understand it's completed. The research would have also included the amount of the capacity. Those findings, I'm still awaiting the report from the contractors.
With respect to the concept of Guyana looking to become a green state, Mayor Holland explained that the need for such a modern-day waste facility will prove beneficial for Lindeners. However, Holland noted that at present, some Lindeners continue to dump their solid waste at unacceptable locations. Those persons should rethink their actions before executing such acts, which causes serious distress to both the environment and to human well-being. Creeks and gullies which pitched in to attract the attention of tourists are two such locations people ought not to dump waste, the mayor added.
Currently, it will be good for Linden because we're trapped with the Cowra Creek, which is under threat. This is on the Wismar shore, and the dumping which was allowed there by the previous administration through a contract between by the RD, then REO, and the Seavons Waste Management, that was a bad decision because below the Cowra Dump site area, you have the Cowra Creek, which falls into one of the remaining watersheds in the region. So that is under threat. So as a result of that, we need to stop dumping at the Cowra Creek and have dumping done at the Karkara site.
In the meantime, with ardent and repeated efforts from both the Linden Town Council and the government at large, Linden is already on the receiving end to have two new compactor garbage trucks to help with the town's ongoing sanitation works. Reporting for MTV News Update, Lashona Gomes Cornelius.
Stay tuned for Court Roundup, the Guyana Stock Exchange, as well as the Demerara Harbor Bridge schedule.
Introducing a new brand of all-weather fiberglass rocking chairs for complete relaxation. We supply quality, durable, and low-maintenance indoor and outdoor table and chairs for your patio, restaurants, cafeteria, reception area, and much more. So sit back and enjoy quality products from FiberTech with guaranteed factory warranty.
Yes, is a beautiful word. It empowers us. It brings satisfaction. And since you can now earn up to 4% cash back on everyday purchases with Scotiabank Gold MasterCard, that's a lot of satisfaction. Plus, you get a welcome bonus. Scotiabank Gold MasterCard is the card that keeps on giving. So it's easier for you. Say yes to even more cash back. Apply today. Call or visit your nearest Scotiabank branch.
Do you know that Gafoos is the largest manufacturer of building materials in Guyana? To prove it, here are some of the items that we manufacture. PVC pipes, PVC fittings, HDPE pipes, and we are the only manufacturer of this product in Caricom. Nails, chain link fencing, PRC fabric, decoiling and straightening and cutting steel rods, aluminium products such as awning windows and shop fronts, sash windows, casement windows, sunbursts, sliding doors, sliding windows, bathtub enclosures, corrugated sheets, purlings, deckings, and curve sheets. We also stock the widest range of quality steel beams, channels, columns, and steel plate. For superior customer service, superior quality, and competitive prices, it's Gafoos, the name you can trust.
The taxes we pay provide revenue for the government to use to develop and improve our country's infrastructure and the life of all Guyanese.
If we pay our taxes, the government will be able to build more roads, schools, hospitals, bridges, and other government facilities.
The government will also be able to use those funds to pay better wages and salaries to public servants and to improve government services.
This will help to attract more investors to our country, create jobs, and reduce poverty.
Let's invest in our country. Pay your taxes.
A message from the Ministry of Finance and the Guyana Revenue Authority.
This is what went down at the Georgian Magistrate Courts on March 20.
An attorney representing the government of the United States on Tuesday served the statements to 31-year-old murder suspect Anthony Thomas, who had fled the U.S. after allegedly stabbing a man in 2011. The attorney, Stacy Gooding, handed over the statements for Thomas to be extradited and sent back to the U.S. to answer to the murder charge. The matter is adjourned until March 23 for additional statements. Thomas reportedly fled to Guyana shortly after an arrest warrant was issued for him in the U.S. for the murder of Keith Frank, who was slain on December 11, 2011. Frank succumbed to a bullet wound to the torso, allegedly during a confrontation with Thomas and others. The victim, whose daughter was 8 months at the time, died 2 months before he would have celebrated his 21st birthday. He had reportedly been living in the U.S. since he was 12. Meanwhile, a Northwest District man was on Tuesday remanded to prison by Senior Magistrate Shardell Isaacs Marcus for the rape of a 12-year-old girl. Peter George was not required to plead an indictable charge, which alleged that during the month of September 2017 at Manowari Village, Maruka, he engaged in sexual penetration with a child under the age of 16. He was remanded to prison until March 27. Reporting for MTV News Update, Godfrey Brooms.
The Ghana Stock Exchange closing prices for trading session 7:65. Let's turn our attention to the Damar Harbor Bridge schedule. That's all we have for you on our newscast tonight. But before we go, here's a major recap of our headlines. Barbies River Bridge may collapse due to low maintenance, says specialist engineer. Social workers urge to demonstrate professionalism as the world celebrates World Social Work Day. Public Health Ministry seeking regulations to protect citizens from the abuse and misuse of medications. And in court, statements serve to have Anthony Thomas extradited to face a murder charge in the U.S. Newscast can be viewed online on MTV's Facebook page and also on our YouTube channel. The news will be rebroadcasted later tonight at 23 hours and at 6 hours on Wednesday, March 21. On behalf of our news and technical teams, I'm Sandy Ramutar, thanking you for watching. Good night.